Home Assistant is increasing in popularity and a lot of people are using it to monitor their energy use. The energy dashboard built into Home Assistant is brilliant and provides an easy to navigate graphical history of your energy consumption. But what if you want to know how much power you are using right now? You can use a series of gauges if you like, but it's much more intuitive to look at a power flow diagram. There's nothing built into Home Assistant to do this, but there are two third-party components that you can install. In this video, I'm going to go over how you configure each of them and highlight their advantages and disadvantages compared to each other. Power flow cards on your dashboard look great and give you a lot of information while also making efficient use of screen space. You can see at a glance where your energy is flowing to and from, overlay other information such as battery charge and energy values too. There are two main options that I've found so far, and please, if there are others out there, then let me know in the comments. Option one is the Tesla style solar power card by ReptileX. And option two is the Powerflow card by Ulic75. They are both similar and unique at the same time, and both require the installation of hacks first. If you already know about hacks and have that installed, then you're all set up and ready to go. But if you don't, then check out my How to Install Hacks video first, and I'll put a link to that in the description for you. Before you even start with displaying data in these Powerflow cards, you of course need to make sure that you have the live power data in the first place. Most solar inverters and battery systems have some sort of smart interface that you can connect into. And as for live grid data, if you have a smart meter, then you can use a third-party device such as the Hildebrand Glow Display that I use. Let's start with the Tesla-style solar power card. The Tesla-style card is perhaps, at the time of recording this video, the most flexible and feature-rich card. At a minimum, you get two bubbles, one for the home and another for the grid. I've got it configured here in full with every possible option enabled. Hanging off the home is my PodPoint EV charger at the top and my Eddy hot water heater at the bottom. You can see that I've added additional information above some of the icons showing total energy consumption for the day, and you can click on each of the buttons to open up more information on the power flow associated with that entity. This card is not straightforward to configure though. Each of these power flows must be provided to the card, so you need to create a number of template sensors first in your configuration files. Make sure you have some way of editing your configuration.yaml file. I suggest the file editor add-on is an easy way to do that, and that's what I'll be using in this demonstration. The first thing you need to create is a sensor that knows how much power your home is using. You can see I've created one here called Home Power. This is the cornerstone of the whole solution and very important to get right. You'll see here that I make a calculation by adding together the grid import power and the solar generation power. I then subtract from that the export power and add on the battery power. If that value is more than zero, it is used as the value for the state of this sensor. Otherwise, a zero value is reported. You obviously need to change the entities in this calculation to your own entities. If you don't have a battery, then take that part out of the calculation. But it's important to know that in this calculation, all sensor values must be positive or zero, apart from the battery entity. The battery entity must be positive when discharging and negative when charging. If you have a Give Energy battery and are using Give TCP like me, then that's the default anyway. Next up, I'm going to piggyback on the hard work done by Aviator LP in creating the APF sensors, or actual power flow. I'll put a link to the original location of that in the description, but I've actually tweaked them a bit because I didn't need the full accuracy of calculating power losses and overheads of the inverters. A rough flow that adds up to the total is good enough for me and removes a lot of the complexity. I'll stick my version of the template sensors on my website, but if you really crave the detail, then please check out Aviator LP's original work. Paste in the APF template sensors, and we're just going to concentrate on the first four. All of the others are self-referencing, providing that you don't change their names, but the first four need some customization. For the APF grid entity sensor, you need to change this entity to your main grid feed power sensor entity. If the entity value is positive when importing and negative when exporting, then you're all good to go substituting that entity here. But if it's negative when importing and positive when exporting, you must delete the zero minus part here. The APF house entity is basically just referencing the home power you created previously. I know it seems silly having two sensors exactly the same, but the idea is that the APF entities are all self-contained and you could just reuse your home power entity elsewhere, and that functionality wouldn't be affected if you decided to delete all of this APF config. The generation entity needs to be set to your solar power output, and finally the battery entity must be the same battery power entity you use to calculate the home power. If you don't have a battery, comment out the state line and uncomment this static zero line here instead, rather than just deleting this entity, because that way the calculations will all still work without any further changes needed. You can have a quick look at the other sensors if you like, but really you just need to save the file and then head on over to Hacks and install the card itself. So if I open my menu and go to Hacks, this is in the front end section. Click on the blue Explore and Download Repositories button and search for Tesla. Select it. And then you'll need to click on the two blue download buttons to get it installed. You'll be prompted to reload, which you need to do as well, but I suggest you actually restart Home Assistant anyway, because you need to enable all of those template sensors you just installed previously. So head on over to Developer Tools, click on Check Configuration to make sure nothing's broken, and click on Restart and restart again. Now you need to put this all together into a card on the dashboard. This all has to be done in YAML, I'm afraid, but it's not that scary. Edit your dashboard and click on the blue Add Card button. Scroll all the way down to Manual. Now, I'm actually going to paste in my known working configuration here and then talk you through it. So if I paste it there, you can see the card has started to populate. You then need to define all of the various power flows to make the lines show correct data. If you use the APF sensors, then these are all defined for you here in my configuration. You can see they've all got sensor.apf something. Appliance 1 and 2 are the additional bubbles that hang off the home bubble. By default, Appliance 1 is a car icon and Appliance 2 is a water heater icon. You need to set these to the power entities for those devices if you are using them, and if you don't have those items, then just don't include these lines and they won't appear at all on the actual card. These next lines for grid entity down to battery entity all define which entity data is shown when you click on those bubbles, and the extra entities here tell the card to display extra data above each of the icons in the bubbles. I'm showing the total energy imported today inside the grid bubble and the battery charge percentage in the battery bubble. I found that the text was a bit too big for my liking, so I installed the card mod component in Hacks, which lets you add CSS adjustments to a card. This style element here just reduces the size of the font for the additional data in the bubbles. There are many other parameters you can have a play with if you want to, so I suggest you have a look at the README on the card's GitHub page, and I'll put a link to that in the description too. The other option is the PowerFlow card. This is a lot simpler to get up and running, but it currently has fewer features. For example, you are limited to a maximum of 4 bubbles for grid, solar, battery and home, so you can't show additional devices such as your car charger or immersion heater. Use Hacks to install this front-end component. So click on the Explore and Download Repositories, and we're going to search for Power Flow Card. There it is. Click on that. There'll be a download button and another download button. You'll be asked to reload the front end, but I suggest you actually go and restart Home Assistant, because quite often it won't find the card otherwise. Next, you'll need to edit your dashboard. So I'll edit my dashboard, add a card, and you scroll down to Manual again. I'm going to paste in my known working configuration, and you'll notice this time it's a lot shorter than before. You don't need to define any special template entities for this one, and you just set the entities for grid, solar generation, and battery here. You can see that I've split out consumption and production entities for the battery. You can do that for any of these. So if you don't have one entity that defines the power flow for your grid, for example, you've got one for export and one for import, you can do the same there. The other entity here is the battery state of charge entity. So if you know how much percentage you've got left in your battery. You can add that entity in here and it'll display it within the battery bubble. As you can see, it's 51% for me here. As with the other card, there are many other options that you can have a play with if you want to, so please check out the README for it if you need to know more. For most people, my values here will be fine, I reckon. So which card should you go for? Well, it's personal preference really. Let's go over the comparison. For the Tesla-style power card, there are a number of pros. You get extra bubbles for additional devices, additional data can be shown in each of those bubbles, and those bubbles are clickable. But there are also a lot of cons. It's very complicated to configure, and although you only have to do this once, it still is quite a bit of work. It has a really big problem rendering in the browser too. Sometimes the bubbles get all mashed up, end up tiny, or power flow lines start pointing all over the place. Compare that to the PowerFlow card, and the pros are that it's very simple to set up. The colour scheme matches the built-in Home Assistant energy dashboard components, and it's got a nice pie chart style home bubble that shows you at a glance what percentage of your current consumption is coming from which source. But it currently has a few cons too. There are no additional bubbles for an EV charger or heater. You can't click on the bubbles for more information, and there's no way to add any extra information into those bubbles. Honestly, I'm torn between these two cards, and I genuinely have them both on my dashboard side by side. I'm leaning towards the PowerFlow card as my favourite in terms of looks. I really like the pie chart style home bubble and consistent browser rendering, but I really do wish it had clickable bubbles, could allow extra templated data to be placed in the bubbles, and display additional entity bubbles. That would make it perfect. Anyway, I hope you found this useful, and if you did, then please give this video a like. If you'd like to see more videos like this, then please subscribe to my channel. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.